Today I am going to present essentially a case study of my experience with one MOOC. My name is Uday Gaitonde. I am a professor of mechanical engineering at IIT Bombay. A good friend of Professor Fatak right from our PhD days, and that's one of the reasons why I am here involved in this workshop and many of Professor Fatak's recent endeavors. This is typically the structure of my talk. I'll say something about which course I offered as a MOOC and quickly why. Then mention about what is common with our normal teaching. When we teach a subject in a classroom, we have some background, some preparation. So between that and a MOOC version of the same subject, what is common and what is different, and then the nitty-gritty of what was involved in the preparation of my course, how was the creation detailed out, how was the operation executed, and finally perhaps an important thing is my personal view on that whole history of offering a MOOC. A similar talk I have had to give at various places, because perhaps in India IIT Bombay was one of the first organization to offer MOOCs. Now there are many others, organization and super organizations, which are getting into it. So a case study of something like this is of interest to everyone. So in a way this is the fourth time I am offering it, third time formally and one time I have done it informally. Every time, depending on the background of the participants, I have to edit a few small things. Now the course I offered was thermodynamics. The reason being that is one of the favorite courses which I have been teaching since I joined on the faculty of this institute. Not only is it favorite, I have enjoyed teaching it, of course initially to students, but then in the Ekalavya NMEICT endeavor, I have even taught it to teachers. It was not the same subject taught, but what was discussed in those 2 week long internet based workshops were how to teach thermodynamics to engineering students, particularly mechanical engineering students. So rather than a teaching of a course, it was sort of a lecture demonstration of how to do good teaching of a course in thermodynamics. The course number for that course in IIT Bombay is ME209, and the first formal recording of this course was in 2009 in the July-November semester, and this was through the NPTEL program of MHRD. And the Center for Distance Engineering Education Program, CDEEP of IIT Bombay, was the IIT Bombay academic unit which helped with that recording. And this was my first exposure to formal recording of a course, editing it and making it available. So although it was informal, these lectures, since you know, a lecture in an unedited form was available within an hour or two of my actual lecture being over. An edited version was available within a few days of that. And transcripts were available quite some time later. And anybody from anywhere inside the institute, even outside the institute, could make use of this course. And I have been continuously receiving by email questions. So that means slowly this has percolated to students and teachers, so I know that people are looking at it. Maybe CDEEP has statistics of how many people latched on to that course, but I have not really looked at it. Then the demonstration to teachers. So Professor Fatak had a project called Teach 1000 Teachers, TTT, and in that, in 2011 June, a 2 week program was conducted. There were some 33 centers and some 800 participants distributed over those 33 centers. And then about a year, year and a half after that, I think from January 2013, the scope was expanded. It became teach 10,000 teachers, so that T10KT. And the first in the teach 10,000 teachers was also ME209, because that was the demand after the exposure of many teachers and their colleagues, and by word of mouth it spread. So although I didn't have 10,000 teachers, I had something of the order of 7,500 or 8,000 teachers. The number of centers went up from 31 to 167. And the spread across India also was wider. Another reason for teaching this course in the MOOC mode is that it is my home ground, so I am very comfortable while teaching this course. And when I talk to others and try to, you know, entice them into offering their course as a MOOC, one of the resistance from them was that, look, I am not yet very comfortable in teaching that course. And I think perhaps that comfort level should be there before you take up MOOCs, because now your audience is very, very wide. You may get questions and comments from any part of the country or even the world. So for some, this comfort level develops maybe after two times teaching. For some, maybe it will take more. I can't tell you when it developed, because I am now a veteran of teaching thermodynamics. So I didn't even realize when that I could say that I am now really comfortable in teaching this course. And another reason which sort of happened, and I realized it more than halfway through, is I had good backup in faculty colleagues. Because, you know, when you commit to teach a course, that is anytime 6 months before the course starts, and once you commit it, the recordings have to take place, the course has to be executed. So something happens to you in between, there has to be a backup who will come in and execute the remaining part. It may not be, maybe the recordings are over, but if for some reason, if you are not available for answering the questions or taking care of any glitches, somebody else should come into your shoes. Another reason for faculty colleagues, not as backup but as co-instructors, is this recording and executing is really intensive work. And if one can share with an appropriately tuned colleague, then your comfort level will be higher, because in between there will be periods of a bit low activity for you. Doing something concentrated over 12 weeks is difficult, but if you say 4 weeks, then a gap or low activity for 2 weeks, another 4 weeks, that's much better. Okay. It's like having some sort of a in semester break or a vacation in our school calendar. It so happened that of this 12 week program for ME209, the way we laid things out, I taught the first 4 weeks, a colleague, Professor Atre, taught the next 2 weeks. Week 7 to 10, again 4 weeks were taught by me, and last 2 weeks were taught by another colleague, Professor Bhandarkar. It turned out to be like that, but then I found that the 2 weeks of Professor Atre in between was real relaxation for me. It doesn't mean that I could run away and spend those 2 weeks in Timbuktu, for example. But the fact is, I don't really have to worry about the nitty-gritty at every hour. That itself is a relaxing feeling. And another thing about this backup is, although I tried to be ahead of the recordings by about a month and a half, during recordings I had an attack of flu and sore throat. 3 weeks of recordings were lost. Because, you know, in a small classroom, even if you have a sore throat, you can have a glass of warm water with you and go through the class. Your sore throat will not be noticed. Students know you, you can get away with it. But in a recording, your voice has to be perfect. A small hoarseness, a small cough or something like that, and no, the recording is not done. The recording boss is sitting behind us, and if he says no, or even if he says the color of this shirt is no good, you have to go home, change your shirt and come back. So because we are not savvy in technicalities, so we finally they are the recording studio bosses are responsible for the technical quality of recording, not the academic quality. So you have to go by them and hence take care of your physical goodness, particularly voice. Now, what is common with normal teaching? I think the preparation is common. The basic preparation, the academic preparation is the same. So what I call brainware, which means everything, in the, even including in the second bullet, whatever you have write on paper, that is notes, text, reference material, reading material, exercises, these are all the same. You have to have this set ready before doing that. But I call that brainware because in spite of this set for teaching anything, something remains in our brain. It never gets put down on the paper. You have all your notes, all your text. Your colleague has taught that, but said, this is all the material, start teaching. The way he or she teaches will be different because the brain part of yours remains in your brain. That it's very, very difficult to transfer that to somebody else. So that is common. Now the last two items, homework assignments, are common, but only a part of those could be implemented in MOOCs as MOOC stands now. We'll come to this detail later. Again, the examinations, the type of examinations which today can be conducted in MOOCs or through the MOOCs media are a bit restricted compared to the various types of examinations that we have in our schools. So that is why I have said homework, assignments and examination. The commonality is only in part. Now what is different? Now when it comes to the actual classroom work, classroom act, things become different. Evaluation becomes different. Interactions become different. So the first thing is the method of delivery is entirely different. Classroom is like this. I am physically in front of you. By looking at your faces, now I am not used to you as a herd here, but my normal class of students, after a few lectures, I know who are the students who are really interested in it. They usually sit in a small group center front. I think that happens in every class. From their facial expressions, from their body language, you can make out what they are thinking, whether they are absorbing at the proper rate or are they lost, shall I go slow, or are they getting bored, shall I skip something and go a bit fast. This consciously or subconsciously happens because we have the people in flesh and blood and we can read through their faces what they are thinking. I think all of us or most of us are teachers and we know this. This doesn't happen. The recording is in front of a camera. After this you will visit the studio where most of these things are recorded. It's just a small room with a camera in front of you, two technicians sitting next to you, but they are not in the view of the camera. And you have a laptop, some other, you know, electronic capture material, some models may be in front of you. That's it. So when you say you are andhere mein baat kar rahe hain, that sort of a thing. And that's not a very comfortable feeling. I know the way I give lectures, my intonations, my behavior is definitely different when it is recorded. For example, my 209 recordings, they were in front of a class of something like 100 students. The camera was roughly at this distance, not at 2 meters in front of me. So I forgot the camera. I mean, the camera was not intruding at all. Although instead of a blackboard, I used a whiteboard. Everything was here, but handwritten. Even my hand could be seen and is recorded. Because there is just a camera here and it records everything. So if somebody watches those videos and somebody watches my ME209X videos, which are purely in front of a camera, even I can make out that, look, this is in front of students and this is in front of only a camera. So that is a different thing, and it will take quite some time for one to be comfortable with the camera. I think only great actors like Amitabh Bachchan and others are purely comfortable in front of camera and other technicians. We are not, and it will take us a lot of time to become, you know, think of the camera as a student, which I don't think is very easily possible. And because of that, the style of delivery also changes. See, in a classroom, you expect interruptions. Either some student will raise a hand confidently or hesitatingly, or you know, you will find a group of students so confused in their faces that you realize that, look, they are itching to ask you a question. Here it doesn't happen. So, you know, if you suppose a particular class is of, typically here our lectures are 55 minutes duration. But if you record 55 minutes and edit it, it will come to only about 45-48 minutes, because in between you spend some time in erasing the board, or if there are multiple boards pushing something up and down, you will spend some time in, you know, checking something, stopping for breath, maybe for a sip of water. Nothing like that happens. You just talk. Okay, and that's another feeling. Of course, we make it shorter clips, not 155-minute oratory. But it's not a very comfortable feeling, because you are just talking and you are not getting any feedback. There is no interruption. So you have to interrupt yourself. You can stop anytime, have a drink of water or go to the toilet and come back. But then the editing team will edit those things out. The interactions with students, they get lost. Here they are totally offline, and hence they are impersonal. Nobody can come and talk to you, and you sit in some corner or on a staircase or on a ledge or under a tree and explain things. That thing is just out of question. Everything is by, as if you are talking to someone on Google Plus or Facebook or earlier Orkut or whatever it is. That sort of a thing. And hence, quite often you don't even, you know, you will hardly ever see the student. And we don't have the patience to go to his registration page and find out how he or she looks like. Sometimes we don't even know whether it's a he or a she, because they give names like, one name in my course is Purgatorio, another name in my course is Gen X EDX. It doesn't matter what it is. Somebody call himself Richard Nixon. If nobody else has registered himself as Richard Nixon, why not? You register yourself as Richard Nixon. But the main difference and a major weakness as things stand today is examinations. Because of this massiveness and the requirement of providing very quick, almost instant feedback, all questions or all parts of examinations are today expected to be machine evaluated. And that means what we call in our normal terminology, multiple choice questions. I'll show you some illustrations. But we know that not much, or only a part, can be evaluated using such questions. I mean, you ask for a theorem to be proved in geometry, or a modification of that called a rider in geometry. There is no way that can be submitted and evaluated, because a machine cannot evaluate it. A human can evaluate it. If in a chemistry thing you ask for how will you prepare some compound, it will have to be described out. That cannot be done. You have to turn it into, what is the first step? List out six options, select one. What is the second step? List out six options, select one. And that means you are giving away half the answer. Because when you just ask, student can, you know, you ask for preparation of sulfuric acid, he can, he is free to write the preparation of potassium permanganate. Here, even if he wants, he cannot prepare potassium permanganate. When you come to subjects like languages or history, where you write essays, verbal description, happens even in biology with sketches, there is no way machine can evaluate it. And hence, in today's MOOCs, these things are not as part of the examination. In thermodynamics, you like in a physics numerical problem or a chemistry numerical problem or a math geometry problem, you start with some figure, some assumption, some construction, then step by step, no way it can be done. I tried to convert it into saying these are the four figures, which is the most appropriate, but you are giving away more than half the answer there. Which assumptions did you make? List out 7-8 assumptions. Maybe 3 of them need to be made to proceed. But when you list out those 3, the 3-1, that's more than a hint for more than 50% of the students. So the examinations are the major weakness, interactions are the minor weakness. Now let me come to the nitty-gritty. So this is preparation, creation, operation, and that part I am starting. Now some disclaimer, my experience is one experience, that was my first experience. So this is, take this only as a case study and not some standard stuff to do. Also this experience is on a platform called EDX. IIT Bombay have a contract with them for various reasons which Professor Fatak explained. However, when you start on the Indian platform Swayam, at least to begin with, things would be very similar, because Swayam is to begin with more or less a clone of EDX. We have taken the software from EDX and we have started editing it. Initially, the editing is essentially cosmetic, in the sense instead of EDX logo, we will have a Swayam logo. Instead of English only as a language, maybe you will have an option of English and Hindi to begin with, and then maybe other languages will follow. But as things progress, Swayam will become slightly and then significantly different. And for that, the feedback from us will be important. So first we will, all of us will work with whatever is available. Today after this, there is a big discussion session on the net with the EDX manager, because my thermo course is over, say hour and a half session, providing feedback, he will ask me questions, but I already have some 3-4 pages of what should be the changes ready. So whenever you do something, what is available you have to live with, but what you want, you have to start demanding that, because then the managers and the software people will slowly start implementing it.
This last part of it, is it a standard part of the design, or we are, because you are developing and customizing it, you are asking this?
Which last part?
This feedback with the program manager of that EDX platform.
That is for the EDX platform feedback, that is one of the standard thing in the closing part.
So anybody who runs a course will have to do that?
Yes, anybody who runs a course on EDX, it's like an exit interview for that course, for the teachers.
Okay.
And for any endeavor, any project of any kind, maybe building a house or getting married or any type of project, at the end, you have to have a review, what happened? What happened well, why, what didn't happen well, next time if you have to do it again, how would you, how different would you do? All that thing.
And what comes from the, as input from the other side, or is this only an exit interview in terms of what you did?
I don't know. This is the first time I'm going through it. Maybe I'll be able to tell you more. Okay. But this is like an exit interview, or the closing comments, or the conclusion. What next? What for the future? If you were to do it again, in what different way would you like to do? It's a good idea. So I hope even in our implementation, this feedback from teachers, feedback from students is always there, but that is more at the academic technical level. This is at the implementation level. Because if you want MOOCs to be successful, we want more and more teachers to come on board. So the comfort level for teachers should go on improving. For that, such a feedback session is going to be very important. So the pre-preparation is the course announcements. Typically, T is the zero time when the course starts. Typically 6 months before that. But you can start preparing 1 year, 2 years. In fact, much of your preparations, if you are going to teach a course which you have been taught, is already there. The brainware and other stuff is already there. You may have to reformat it. We'll come to that. But this is the course announcement to the outside world. It will be on the Swayam platform. In my case, it was on the EDX platform. Now, because the announcement is on the web, just the way you have a trailer of a movie or the pilot episode of a serial, you have to create what is known as an introductory video. Okay. And this is about 2 minutes in duration. They have seen my video, so you know what that introductory video is. It's a jhalak of what is expected. Some people will be, you know, disheartened and will not register, but maybe more will register. In my registration graph, I will show it to you. When the introductory video was put up, there was a change in the slope of registrations. And 1 month before that, when an email, massive email went to all people registered with EDX, there was another significant rise in the slope. And then you have to create your team of colleagues and primary teaching assistants who will help out with solutions, making new exercises, modifying them, cutting, pasting, editing. The teaching assistants or technical assistants as early as possible. Because the earlier you get them on board, your comfort level will be increasing. Labor will get distributed.
So there's one small departure we are
making in the model vis-a-vis this last statement that you made. In the case of higher education course of the IIT kind, you can straight away ask for a teaching assistant to be available. Obviously, none of my colleagues here are going to be. So we are looking at the possibility that this is a group affair rather than being an individual person championing the course. And we have also worked out a distributed mechanism where once the draft course becomes available from a team of people, it is shared with a larger group of fellow colleagues in that same subject, and that forms the review team.
So instead of teaching assistants, you may call them teaching associates.
Perhaps. Whatever. So I'm just trying to point that out.
Here is as things happened. That doesn't mean they have to happen again exactly like this.
Precisely.
This is a case study. You learn from it and modify as needed. The second part of preparation is what I call the brainware, the real meat of the subject. This will be available. Unless this is available, you won't sign up for a course. Then remember, here everything has to be electronically transmitted. See, usually in our school teaching or even college teaching, the whatever is taught is just verbal. But whatever is shown is usually sketched on a blackboard or maybe whiteboard nowadays. There may be a few slides, but I think slides come into picture only when you go into the post-12th thing. Up to 12th, I don't think slides and videos are very significantly used. Models are used definitely, but here all your slides, models, etc. have to be in the electronic format. Okay. Even you can write, I will show you a demonstration of this writing. So you can write, but that also has to be prepared. It will have to be electronically captured and sent. And because of this, you can create animations and videos as per your requirement. And that is why you have to have at some level, here we have locally, but at the all India level, maybe you will have some centers where significant animation backup and expertise could be available. Now you will have a set of exercises. They may need to be modified because of the larger distribution. So in a For example, in my typical exercises, we never worried about whether an exercise is small or large. In this particular case, the students expect more or less uniform difficulty and uniform time in each exercise. So larger ones need to be split into two trivial, smaller ones, just get them, either combine them or neglect them, things like that. The quizzes examinations also need to be modified, just as I said earlier, because many of the parts of our quizzes and examinations you will not be able to implement in the MOOCs as it exists today. Okay. And that is a sore point even with me. But the remaining part you will have to convert into either click one of many figures or just enter a small number or write a formula or select one of many, say true or false. or select more than one out of many, such something which is machine evaluated. The third one is to fit this into the MOOC, the EDX or the Swayam structure. And here, you know, when we typically teach a subject, we say, look, I have 40 lectures of 55 minutes. At the school level, it may be different, but so many minutes and so many lectures for teaching that subject. And we lay it out, so many hours for this, so many hours for this. Here, a similar structure, but because it is recorded, we typically have three or four levels available to us. And in the initial Swayam structure, these are known as section, subsection, unit and subunit. Now this is either will be given to you soon or will be electronically transmitted to you. There is a four level structure. Here the what I mean by this course is the complete subject. The first level is sections. This could be something like major parts or chapters or units in your syllabus, something like that. Because in EDX, everybody makes the sections as weeks, maybe with some names or sometimes without. I tried doing that. More or less is okay, but need not think in terms of weeks, because there will be some chapters which will be over in 1 week, maybe less than 1 week. Some chapters may need more than 1 week. So it's better to talk in terms of, for example, triangles could be one section in geometry, or factorization of polynomials could be another section in algebra, okay? Or work and energy could be a section in physics. It's for you to decide. These are major chunks, and a particular subject is expected to have around 10-15 sections. Don't make it too many. Okay. Thermodynamics had 12 sections. Now each section is partitioned into a number of subsections. And you can say a subsection is typically a lecture or a major part of a big section. And for example, you could call it in triangles, congruent triangles could be one section. Or similarity of triangles could be another section. Some theorem regarding triangles, Pythagoras theorem for example, could be one section. Physics, kinetic energy could be one section. It depends on you. So major part, minor part. Now beyond that, in each section you have two levels, a unit and a subunit. I find that the four levels are a bit too many. One can essentially do with three levels, the section, subsection, unit. The subunits are actually a unit within a unit. We hardly ever used it, but we used it when we found that recording something in one go is difficult. So instead of a 20-minute video, you create 4-5-minute videos or 2-10-minute videos. Those could be subunits. They are logically essentially one part, but for some physical reason they are separated. One place where the subunit was useful was for discussion forum. At the end of every unit, you have a subunit saying, this is your discussion forum. Whatever you want to, whenever you want to ask a question, go there and ask a question. Okay. The subunit is essentially a small item, like a video, a document to read, a quiz to attempt, or a forum to participate. I have asked that copies of this made available to you. Coming back to our things, then in our typical school things, the examinations are pre-decided, either semester one examination annual or semester two examination, maybe one or two mid-semester examination, and a large number of or a reasonable number of so-called unit tests. Here the school calendar doesn't matter, your calendar matters, and depending on the partitioning that you have done, depending on sections and subsections, you can include quizzes and examinations. If you feel like After every subunit, you can have a small quiz, or you can have a bigger quiz at the end of a section. You can have, and you do have, a big final examination at the end of the course, but in between you can have a midway examination for the course. It's, the structure is totally left to you. And the location of this and the type of this quiz and the fora for discussion is totally left to you.
So when you compare this with your face-to-face course that you actually run here,
right,
how does this unit subunit
maybe? The type of discussion and the level of discussion is entirely different. But the reason for that is not just MOOC and non-MOOC. The reason for that
I'm only looking at the time breakup. So will this be corresponding to, let us say, one complete semester course on thermodynamics?
Yes, yes, it is.
So what you call a course is one complete
semester. One subject. 40 lectures of 55 minutes each. Lectures come tutorials. One big 3-hour examination at the end, worth roughly 30-40% of the weight. And in between, I generally do not have a mid-semester. I have some 6 or 7 quizzes, typically once every fortnight. But a mid-semester timetable is available. People do conduct one mid-semester and 1 or 2 quizzes before that, 1 or 2 quizzes after that. But in, at least in the EDX scheme of things, one subject is supposed to be one subject, one course is supposed to be one subject taught in one semester. But we can change that in Swayam. For example, you know, instead of geometry for 9th standard being one full thing, if the geometry of 9th standard, I don't really know, but suppose it contains properties of circles, properties of triangles, and properties of parallelogram, then you could have a small MOOC on just properties of circles,
yes,
level 9 standard, properties of parallelograms, level 9 standard, and properties of triangles, level 9 standard. You may have something with properties of circles level 6 standard. That could be another course rather than a full, you know, at 6 standard, mathematics is mathematics. It's not split into this. The split begins at 9, 10th level. So it, the choice is ours. It could be, even in EDX, there are courses as small as 3 weeks and as long as 12, 13 weeks. In fact, when I proposed this 12-week course, there was tremendous pressure from EDX to split it into two. And me and my colleague spent a week, 2 weeks trying to do a formal split. But then we decided, no, it's not proper to do that. So at least for the first rendition, which is now complete, we put our foot down and saying single subject, 12 weeks.
Okay.
But I may change my view based on the feedback next time.
Typically, when we look at our syllabus document, which sort of governs, you know, how many periods are allocated for each unit of content. Typically, of the order of 14 periods, 15 periods is what is allocated for each of those units, which corresponds to about 2 to 3 weeks in any case. So we could perhaps consider as one.
Yes, it can be.
But what could be the shortest one?
3 weeks.
No, but 3 weeks means how many student hours investment?
See, typically 3 weeks of a typical subject being learned. So in a, even in a school, I think 6 or 7 subjects. So one of them for 3 weeks is, I think, a good enough module. Now, because it is on the web, you need to have transcription, because the recording of our audio may not be perfect, or our pronunciation may not be easily understandable by people. It's particularly true when my Thermo course or EDX courses go all over the world. Okay. And there have been complaints saying the Indian accent is not suitable for in this country and that country and all that. Hence, transcription is made available.
Sir, in 12th standard, some topics are very large. Single slit say, diffraction jo hai, बहुत ही लंबा है तो इन शॉर्ट टर्म्स इसका कैसे बनाएंगे
दैट इज लेफ्ट टू यू आई कांट गिव ए प्रिस्क्रिप्शन
क्योंकि इस 40 मिनट के पीरियड में भी हम इसको पूरा नहीं कर पाते हैं कुछ टॉपिक्स ऐसे होते हैं
एक्चुअली देन यू हैव टू थिंक एंड आई हैड टू थिंक बिकॉज़ The typical video here is not supposed to exceed 15 minutes. But that doesn't mean that in 15 minutes everything has to be complete. For example, the big proof, take for example the proof of the Pythagoras theorem. The Pythagorean theorem, what the theorem is about, can be explained maybe in 10 to 15 minutes. That will be one video. Then the basic idea, how are you going to approach the proof? There are three or four different ways of proving Pythagoras theorem. So maybe depending on the level, he could just talk of one method, or depending on the level, he can say, these are the four different approaches, but I am going to look at this approach. That could be the second video. Then the basic idea and construction. There is one proof in which you draw squares on the three sides of the right triangle. That could be one video, maybe 7-8 minutes, doesn't matter. Then the construction from the vertex across the hypotenuse into that square, and then trying to now show that this square is equal to part of that big square, another square, that could be another. In the actual area equivalent, showing congruence of triangles, etc., could be one part. In fact, I had to spend, I am coming to that, significant time in restructuring and splitting my thing into this. I will show you my course also if time permits. Now you will work with technical teams, and particularly a studio team and what we call the MOOC lab team. MOOC lab is something which you have visited already, I suppose. Studio you will be visiting after this lecture. Not visited MOOC lab. Okay, so you will visit studio and MOOC lab. Now recruit teaching assistant or teaching associates, recruit or make available, train them if required. And this is common with our normal things, documents, prepare as needed. Instead of making copies and handing out, you will make PDFs, put them up on the website for others to download. Now in the Indian case, you apart from transcription, you will have translation also perhaps. So that's going to be an added thing. For transcription here, we used a commercial software called Dragon. I have to train it by reading out some of its standard passages and then reading out some of my passages and providing the text to it. It turns out that of the three faculty members here, Dragon was very comfortable with my pronunciation. The reason may not be that my pronunciation is very clear, but the transcripts of my 2009 videos and the audio were also used as training. So Dragon had about 40 hours or 50 hours of training with my voice. So the correctness was of the order of 80%, 80 to 90%. In case of a colleague, Professor Bhandarkar, just 2 weeks of work, but it was good, maybe 50-60%. But in case of Professor Atre, there is no reason. It did not go beyond 30 or 40%. So I don't know this.
I think the thing was he was suddenly going up and then lowering. So that one should avoid. Like if your voice is fluctuating too much, because it's a machine, so, and it's a software.
See,
so it
humans
doesn't recognize.
Are very, very tolerant when it comes to, the up and down of voices, frequencies and all that. And that's what we have learned, and machine is not tolerant. Yeah. Now, overall structure, this is essentially what we do in this, except that we have to have weekly updates and notices.
So this transcription is done only for those videos which, like the typical intro video where you were there?
No. Each and every video is a transcription. I'll demo my course actually to you, so you will see how the transcription works. Now this is, course handouts are always there, but remember that what we tell in class regularly, here we can't say in a video. So you have to have notices and put them up on the website. How to behave well, what behavior will be considered obnoxious and penalized, how to behave on a forum. And typically in a class you come on the first day of the week and say something about what is going to happen in that week. Here you don't say something like that, but you provide a weekly update, that is as a notice board. Every week you put up a new notice saying what is going to happen and what do you expect. I'll also show this. Now, this is the main thing. This is now the nitty-gritty. Although we are used to a typical class timing of, say, at the school level, maybe 45 minutes, at the high school or college level, maybe 55 minutes to 1 hour. The early MOOCs, their feedback is that the video should be of the snippet kind, that is short, 5 to 12 minutes. The reason for that is the feedback from those, the first few renditions of MOOCs at various places is this, and this is obtained using keyloggers, is that if the video is long, people lose interest very fast. So I have seen a graph being plotted. If the video is 2, 3, 4 minutes, anybody who latches onto it goes through it almost 100%. The moment it goes beyond 7, 8 minutes, people try to while away. Beyond 15 minutes, people look at it less and less. So somebody gives you a video of 1 hour to look at, 4 or 5 minutes, you will just sample it and go away. So that is why it's recommended, and I think it's a good recommendation, that make it a snippets of 5 to 15 minutes. Aim around 10 minutes. And what I found a good way to do is, whenever we pause for breath or pause for, or whenever we erase a board and start something new, perhaps that is perhaps a good point to stop a video and go to another video. Remember, because it's a snippet, the snippet need not be complete. It need not have a full derivation, need not have a complete proof. But because of our experience, we must be able to split it into two or three at appropriate points where we tend to pause for some reason or the other. Maybe because at that time some student usually asks a question, or you have done enough thing on the board, you need to erase it and start it. I can't give you a prescription, but something like this you will have to do depending on your own subject and perhaps even your own style of teaching. I am told this is very difficult to do. When I went to Tata Institute of Social Sciences, and they just threw up their hand. This is no sociology. Once I start lecturing, 1.5 hours I have to talk. There is no pause in between. I said, look, I know nothing about sociology, but I recommended that lady record the whole 1.5 hours and then go through that again and again to find where it is possible. And I'm sure she is going to, after 10-12 minutes, abhi enough hua, let me pause and think about it. And that's the where you should break the video. So the video are not logical splits, they are physical splits more or less. If you can put in some logic there, it's okay, but even otherwise it's not needed. Then we recorded our snippets. They are in a very raw form with gigabytes of memory, but the advantage of that raw form is it's very easily editable. That's what my technical team tells me. But it's not easy to handle and pass on and for me to look at on my home computer. So they convert it into MP4, sent to me. I have to, you always make errors while recording. So you go through it, re-record a part or make them correct something. You may have made an error while saying something. You may have made an error while writing something. Some of these errors can be corrected by editing. Some of these errors cannot be corrected, in which that small part you will have to re-record. See to it that you wear the same shirt when you insert it. The shirt or your sari should not suddenly become green to red for 3 seconds and go back to green. Some continuity is needed. Okay. And then prepare the weekly structure and prepare the quizzes and examination. I'll show you the structure, and again this PDF will be made available to you. Now this is week 7 of my course. Now the subsection names I have just called lectures. But the title is, for example, here, Introduction to Second Law, the Heat Engine, Temperature Levels and Performance Parameters, and Reversible Processes, finally a quiz. So this was the structure of that week. So this is the section name, week 7, subsections 1, 2, 3, 4. The fifth subsection is a quiz. The content subsections are 4. In the first subsection, there is a unit called introduction, another unit called the second law, third unit called some historical comments, fourth unit called the Kelvin-Planck statement. And in the first unit, there is only one subunit, which is a text, something for you to read. This is a document and it is a text which is provided to the students. That is the introduction. It is just what you say at the beginning when you start an entirely new topic. Then a unit called the second law, it has two subunits. One is a video called the second law of thermodynamics and the discussion forum. You will find that in most of the units, the last subunit is a discussion forum for people to ask questions and discuss anything. And you will notice that wherever there is a video, for example, here in this engines and reservoirs unit, there are three subunits, two of them are videos, one below the other, the third one is a discussion forum. Now when it comes to two temperature heat engines, 2T heat engines, I have four videos one after another in the same unit, four subunits followed by a forum. And you look at the duration of the videos, 11 minutes, 26 seconds, 7 minutes, 7 minutes, 7 minutes, 5 minutes, 9 minutes, 3 minutes, 10 minutes, 9 minutes. So that's the typical thing. I have not aimed at a particular thing, but I have aimed at something between 5 and 15 minutes. And in this particular week, it's not very heavy in time because it is very heavy in assimilation. The total time is about 1 hour 50 minutes. But there have been other weeks where it has gone as much as almost 3 hours. Okay, this is one of those lighter weeks. At the school level, maybe this will be lower than 2 hours. Okay, this is at the college level, professional college level, so this tends to be higher. There is no guideline about this, but I expect primary school level, this will be pretty low. Middle school, it will increase. High school, junior college, it will be still higher. Professional colleges, it will be still higher. The others are simply indices to keep track of this. So this also is being distributed to you either physically or electronically. So now you notice here that this is the basic introduction to the second law. And Carnot theorem, etc., comes in the second week of the second law. The second law required 3 full weeks. So week 7, week 8, week 9 were devoted to second law. In that, I had to, now when I teach second law, I teach it as a continuum. The 55 minutes end of a class is just a distraction. I may even stop halfway through a derivation and start from that point next time with just a 1 minute linking introduction. Here, it's not that. You don't worry about 55 minutes. You worry about topics, subtopics, subsections and themes. So depending on your subject, you will have to lay out this, and this is where a lot of thinking time is needed and you will have to spend that. Now prepare quizzes and examinations. Here also the main headache is you will have to give up some questions or some types of questions because they cannot be evaluated the way things stand today. And other questions you will have to convert into a multiple choice format. Then this is technical, pass the structure to the MOOC lab, they prepare the transcript, you check the transcript, then okay transcripts go back to the lab and the everything is then uploaded and there is a set of beta testers, that means students who are specifically assigned, students or associate, they go through it before it is really published to see whether you have made any mistake or some link is missing or something. Now when it comes to operation, keeping track of what happens in any discussion forum is the main task because this is the interaction. Which one?
What is a creation? Creation level 1. Huh. Yes, second one.
See, once you create that structure and record it, The recording studio will provide the recordings, you have to okay them. If there are any errors, you have to get them corrected. Similarly, the transcripts are provided, you have to go through the transcript. Reasonable amount of editing is needed. So not only the teacher, but his assistants help him out in that editing. All this material is then passed on to the MOOC lab electronically. That means you send an email, this transcription is okay. And then the MOOC lab, the two ladies you see behind them, dark red and light red, or dark red and pink, they do the job. I don't even know how it is done. And it gets uploaded on the site. And because I am a teacher, the moment it is uploaded, it is available to me, to the technical team and to the TA team, before it is made available to the rest of the world. And the TA team then becomes beta testers. That means they go through the whole thing, check out the videos, make themselves a fool by giving wrong answers. Because you have to check out that the wrong answers are marked as wrong and the right answers are marked as right. Now coming to operation, you know, in a class, a student is physically in front of you. So he or she will not use unacademic, unparliamentary, undiplomatic language. They will not make off the track comments. But that's not true. This is like a Facebook. You can say anything about anything, even unrelated stuff. So you have to see to it that unrelated stuff is deleted. Obnoxious stuff is either edited out or deleted. And whatever which needs to be answered or commented on is commented on. And this respond as needed, this part is something which is important. Because when somebody asks a question or makes a comment with an underlined or unmentioned but request for response, you have to respond. And sometimes somebody will make an incorrect statement, either inadvertently or because he doesn't understand properly. If it is totally wrong, delete it and say that I am deleting it because it is totally wrong. But it's a small mistake, correct it. You have the editing facility for anybody's post. Now weekly updates, once or twice a week. This is something like you put up on a notice. When I show you my course, that will be clear. If you want to immediately inform something, email facility is available. It will reach even those who don't log in, it will reach their inbox. Then just the way when we conduct an examination, there is no such thing as returning the answer books because they get immediate feedback. But if you find that a particular quick question has been answered wrong by a large number of students, maybe you would like to comment on it. So, such feedbacks can be provided. And assignment feedback rarely, because even if they submit the assignment, there is no way you can evaluate hundreds and thousands of them. The third and maybe the final part of the operation is entrance survey. In a school, we know who the students are. The attendance register, even their background files are available in the office. Here you have to create a questionnaire to capture what is their background, because when you go and teach 9th standard geometry, 9th standard geometry students or math students are there. Here it's an open. So anybody, for my thermodynamic course, I have said that typically this is a second year mechanical engineering course, may be useful to others. People who claim they were born in 1894 have registered. People who claim they were born in 2014 are also registered. Nobody could claim in 2015 because that was a drop down menu, 2015 was not mentioned there. But if you were to leave it blank or provide up to 2020, people would have been born in 2020 also. So that feedback, you know, take it with a big fistful of salt. And finally, create a final examination. It's a slightly different format. And at the end of everything, review the work done. So this review we have started, but there is a formal review today evening at 5:30. Now what is the current status of my course ME209X? X is the nomenclature added by EDX. The X of EDX comes there. It was a 12-week course. It was completed nicely. The final examination was last week, 17 October to 22 October. That also is over. The course formally ended on 27th October. Till 27th October, they could edit their names, etc., so that the certificates are properly printed. The certificates, I am told, are being printed. Printed means created. They will be uploaded on each person's site. You can download and print. Now, finally, my personal view of all this. Experience is not bad at all. I don't regret at all having done this. But it's nowhere near a one-man show. I just could not have managed without the support of teaching associates, teaching assistants, colleagues, and all that tech and admin staff which is there. Actually, there is a big team. I need to interact maybe only with 4, 5, 6 of them.
Around 60 people.
About 60. I was going to say 70, but of that order. And whenever I go, I say, hello, sir, good evening, sir. And these are not people of the student age. So I assume that they belong to this team which is helping out with my course.
But then is that also not true of the regular IIT, that there won't be that many number of people assisting you with your course? You simply are not counting them. The library,
No, but in an IIT thing, normal course, all I need is a room, the duster and all that. And my TAs are there, colleagues are there, but there is no tech admin staff. Because here it is, because it is recorded, it is transcribed, everything is electronically handled. That is the reason we need it.
No, but
that anywhere happens. This is the additional technical team for MOOC. See, that what IIT provides, any other school will also be providing. And that infrastructure is there. But this is additional team for recording, transcribing, managing the whole, the internet and web business. That is the additional stuff. Now about the EDX system, I find the system is good, no major complaints. But of course, like anything, once you do it, you find it could have been better. And I have listed out quite a few things for telling them today evening. The system is more user friendly. It's not so teacher friendly. But looking at that, it is, the students are the consumers. So I shouldn't blame them for being user friendly. So I have no complaints. In fact, if I were to create something like this, the first aim should be to make it the consumer friendly, that is student friendly in this case. But I would definitely try to make it more teacher friendly, particularly from the point of view of being able to handle interactions and being able to handle evaluation. The evaluation, examination, quizzes are the weakest point in this. I've already said the first bullet. And because it's an open forum, the students make full use of the forum. And particularly during quiz time, you have to be very careful. You know, there are some questions where you have to say true and false. And one of the do and don'ts says that do not ever hint at the answer of a question. But even then a student says, in quiz 3 question 1, I ticked this and I got a wrong answer. It's a true and false question. So isn't he giving away the correct answer by saying I ticked this and I gave a wrong? So, you know, somebody has to sit there regularly, TA, teacher, every few minutes or every few hours, and any such thing has to be immediately deleted. Today it is not possible to upload any written material, whether the essay type or a worked out solution type. That's a major weakness. And even if it is uploaded, there is no way a machine can evaluate this. The only thing is, it's possible perhaps in a blended way where you upload something, your teacher only downloads only your classes thing, not the other things, and evaluates. Maybe that is possible. Derivations, proofs, numerical except, you know, fill in the blank type of a numerical. What was the terminal velocity of that ball as it fell down from the aircraft? 102.4 meters per second. 102.4 is what you enter. That can be checked out. but not how you arrived at that 102.4. Quizzes have to be machine evaluable. Or now, one of the differences is that the student group is very diverse. Currently on EDX, there is no restriction on who can sign up. And initially, Swayam will also be like that. I'm not complaining it, but this is a fact. The required background of the student is not checked. For example, in second year thermodynamics, second year engineering thermodynamics, you expect that high school mathematics, everybody is comfortable with. High school physics, everybody is comfortable with. High school chemistry, everybody is comfortable with. But if an 8th standard student joins, he says, you are talking about thermal energy, I know nothing about it. He should not have registered for this course in the first place. But even then, there are people, I said, there is a steam table. If your value is not around value of temperature or pressure, you may have to interpolate it immediately. Sir, what is interpolation? Now, this is expected of a 12th standard or a first year or second year engineering student, but out there anything happens. And because of this and because of some nasty comments made, once in a while you get a feeling that your effort is going west. In some sort of, I think this is from Kalidasa, Arasikeshu Kavitva Nivedanam, maybe a few of you will understand, that sort of a thing happens. That is, you are trying to make somebody who just doesn't appreciate things to understand the nuances of what you are teaching. Finally, will I do it again? The answer is yes, but I will do it in a different way. I would definitely like a better system. Swayam to begin with may not be, but I am sure as time progresses, you will have a Swayam plus or a Swayam plus plus or Swayam beta, gamma, delta up to, so long as it doesn't hit the omega barrier, it's okay. And of course, from the evaluation point of view, at least today, the blended mode will be superior. The weakness I didn't mention, one weakness is evaluation. The second weakness is what we have, the tutorial or the problem solving sessions. Those, where you are there, but you have just given three problems, you solve them and I will see where you get into trouble. That sort of a thing which you do, particularly in mathematics.
Where they get stuck up.
That is something which you just can't do here.
So maybe you can do one thing, sir.
Suppose we have got five states, so we will assign, every state we will be having 10 teaching assistants.
So, essentially going to the blended mode.
Yes, yes.
In some way or the other.
So then we will download and then we will evaluate.
Blended mode will definitely be superior. Okay. And I have already started talking to CS and IT people whether machine evaluation of worked out problems in thermodynamics can be attempted. Okay, that's a big software project I was told, but unless you start it, you don't even know how big it is. Let me show you my course. Now, this is my course page. When you log in and latch on to the thermodynamics course, actually when you log in to your EDX, this is what you will see. But your home ground is your dashboard. And on the dashboard, you will see all the courses in which you have taken some interest by registering. Just for interest, I have registered for so many. But my own course is here. Because it's the oldest course now, others are new ones of others. This is thermodynamics. Because it is all over, you have to look at only archived course. Archived means it is not live. The major action is over. And when you look at the archive course, you will see the page which I showed you first. And this is essentially the notice board. This is the current notice board and this is the auxiliary notice board. On this notice board, I'll go down. This is the on July 28, one day before the course started on July 29, this notice went up, welcome. So this is the first notice you will put up on the notice board. And after that, roughly every week, so you will find week 2 update, something about week 2, something about week 3, then this is about week 4, then week 5. Whenever there is a change of major topic or a change of instructor, there will be something more, otherwise things will be routine. So every week there will be updates. Now near the final examination, somebody wanted my paperwork to be scanned, so there is an update about that. Final examination related updates, some paperwork of Professor Bhandarkar, again final examination, certificate related. We have created an exit survey. So these are essentially notices which are put up. These are the handouts. So here, this is also material available, but not short enough to put straight away on the notice board. So this is like, you know, notes on this subject are available. Please go to this particular room and pick up your copy, that sort of a thing. So this is about this course. So this was put up in the beginning. So what is this course about and all that. Then another is the contents of this course. So this is the syllabus of that course. And similarly, you have list of textbooks, references, grading policy, collaboration guidelines, do and don'ts on the forum, tips for success during quizzes. Then a big set of steam tables was used, that was also made available on the in the PDF format. And this is the riot act pertaining to the final examination. Do this, don't do this, when will it be open, what is the deadline and all that. Ends with best of luck as usual. Now this is the main courseware page. Here you will see week 1 entrance survey, week 2, week 3, week 4. Week 4 I have expanded. Week 5, week 6, week 7, week 8, week 9. 12 weeks final examination and exit survey. So this is the main structure, out of which the week 7 structure is something which I have shown you. So there were introduction to second law, the heat engine, temperature levels and performance parameters, reversible processes and quits. And if you click on this section, now this is the subsection. So now there are 1, 2, 3, 4 units. The first unit is just a document. It says we are now halfway through this course. We now begin an exploration of the second law of thermodynamics or something. I could have made it into a video, but that video would have been only 1 minute long. So rather than a video, I decided write it down. It's just some 7-8 lines, 8 sentences and be done with it. Now this is the second unit where I talk about the second law of thermodynamics, and below that is the discussion forum. Now the scheme is, this is the video window and on the side is the transcript. And as I play the video,
welcome back. So we are meeting after a gap of 2 weeks, and now we are ready.
2 weeks because Professor Atre taught something in between.
The second law of thermodynamics, perhaps the
notice that as the video progresses, the transcript, the current sentence color changes.
Important part of the moment. In this series of lectures, next 2 to 3 weeks, we will be studying the second law and some aspects of it. We will quickly revisit the first law and the zero.
Now suppose you are looking at it again and you want to go somewhere else. Either click on that position, the transcript will change, or you click on that transcript, the video will go to that position. So it is interactive that way also.
We can assume, for example, higher and lower temperature is a limitation.
For example, you can go back and go here, the video will go back there.
Changing the directions of all interactions. Changing the sign of energy change.
If you think I am speaking very fast, you can reduce the speed to 50%, or if somebody feels I am speaking, or you can even go faster.
What we find are the following. Zero law dictates the existence of thermodynamics under certain
conditions. So, another thing is, facilities are provided for downloading the video and downloading the transcript separately. These are two different files. Download video is the video including its audio.
डाउनलोड करेंगे तो वीडियो अलग डाउनलोड होगा, ट्रांसक्रिप्ट अलग
डाउनलोड होगा ट्रांसक्रिप्ट And if you run the video using any standard video showing software, the transcript is in a format that it will come as subtitles in your video automatically. Here it's not happening because it is being shown side by side. So you don't have to print and read the transcript, it comes as subtitles there.
Okay.
So directory mein rakho, video chalu karo, transcript aa jayega. Now here there is a discussion. Now there is only one, what is the meaning of thermodynamic basis? Nobody has responded, somebody has put up something. Now it becomes difficult to keep track of these forums or fora because they are at the end of every unit, the last subunit is this. So the facility is made available that there is a discussion tab in which all the discussions are put together. So for example, this is notes and slides. So this pertains to, if it pertains to something, it will be shown here. Somebody has asked a question, somebody has commented on it. I love the professors, I hate the professor, everything will be there. Some errors are also pointed out. So this is something about exact differential. Now when it is, this will be on week 8, entropy 3, the question will be asked there. All the discussion will be there, but it is transferred here also automatically. So a person like me doesn't have to go to all those different places and answer questions. There is one place in which all those things are tabulated. And if I respond to this place, at this place, a copy is also available there. It's directly linked. Now, apart from that, we made a calendar showing week by week. When the material for a particular week will be released and when will be the deadline for that week's quizzes and finally when the final examination begins and final examination deadline. In fact, this is something which we created and EDX appreciated that this is a very. Now, because I am an instructor, this instructor part comes here. If I am a student, this instructor part will not be seen. In the instructor part are all the administrative things. For example, I know some statistics, who is there, who are registered today, I mean up to today and all that. I can send email, I can see some analytics, I can download the performance of a student or something. I can administer students, throw them off the course or register them or provide them different status and so on. I'll show you some statistics here. Now this is a recent thing which they have started. Now this is a statistics which they have provided. This is the student enrollment. In December 20 or 21 it was announced and immediately registration started. Now, this first kick started when the intro video was put up, but the main thing starts a month before the beginning, this is 22 June, when a mail goes out, email goes out. And then this is very near the start of the course, the final jump, then it gets more or less saturated. Now this is the enrollment. The engagement is different. Notice here I have something like 19,500 students roughly, okay. 19,500. But if you come to engagement, engagement means those who are active, those who have done at least some activity. In the very first week, 5,246 active students, out of which 3,228 watched a video. 2508 tried a problem, at least. But after that, you notice that the interest goes down and down and down. Finally, in the last week, only something like 1,200 active students. And I find that something like 600 have cleared the course. We define 50% as the performance. So 600 have cleared the course. So if you compare it with 19,000, that's pretty small. But if you compare it with those 5,000, then it is about 10%. Because out of 19,000, I would say 14,000 they just registered because at some time they felt like registering, they never took interest. Actually, these are the 5,000 or maybe even less than that who were really interested in that course and did something. So 600 or 550 passing out of 5,500 is 10%, which I think is a good enough for the first MOOC attempt. And another thing which is of interest is the geography, worldwide. See, 164 countries represented. That's pretty good. I think the total number of countries is of the order of 200. Of the order of 200, I said. Because there are some things whether, you know, China doesn't consider Taiwan as a country and all that happens. Plus or minus one or two will always be there. 33% of students are from India. 17% of students are from the United States. The third one is a distant third, Egypt. But you look at the details, 6367 from India, 3255 about half of them from the United States. Now, Egypt, United Kingdom, Brazil, Mexico, Pakistan, Canada, Spain, Germany, you name it, the country is there. Colombia, France, India, reasonable number too. And even such, did we see Pakistan somewhere? Yes, Pakistan was there, 384. Iran, 135. Venezuela, Tunisia, Ecuador. And there are some countries where there is a representation of just one. Zimbabwe, one. Turkmenistan, one. So these are really small odd countries. This is for the 19,000. And here also, you just, it is a geographical information system. So Canada is 377. Alaska is part of United States, so it is 3255. Brazil 511. Peru 164. You even come to know where those countries are. Let's go to the Ebola range, Nigeria 143. Mali 1, Algeria 102, Morocco 183, Libya 5, obviously, but Egypt 573, Jordan 42, is Israel represented? Israel 54, I saw Palestine somewhere, State of Palestine 10, Saudi Arabia 95. Okay, so that brings me to the formal end of this.
As per this course means like one subject, sir. Right. If a student enrolled and completed this through examination and a certificate definitely providing by you people, and only in the particular subject, it is not a like one qualification.
Right.
Or a course. See, in what way the student is benefited. So, though he has gained the knowledge in that particular area, no doubt, but in what way it will be useful in future?
See, it is the same thing that a student who is not registered for a course goes through an excellent textbook, solves all the problems. What is his status after that? That is the status after going through a MOOC course, even if he goes through that very thoroughly. You know, he will claim that I have solved all the problems, but for that claim to be accepted by someone, then he goes to a teacher. He said, I have studied everything about circles. Now I want to study triangles. You teach me. The teacher has to accept that he has studied everything and knows enough about circles. Say. So he said, look, you claim it, but you sit with me. I'll give you a few questions. You solve them. Then I will satisfy myself whether you are well prepared or not. And that is why I am all for blended mode. Okay. Evaluation and also, you know, tutorials. Helping out a stuck student. It cannot be done across the screen. discussion forum, I can't, you know, hardly any possibility of somebody uploading, I tried to prove something or I tried to derive it this way, at this stage I am stuck, or I am getting a different result, I must have made a mistake but I can't find out. If he comes and sits with you, you go through step by step and say, ah, this is where you have made a mistake.
Sir, our system always talks about improvements and all. Is there any method of it? Suppose a child has already done the examination and it is over, the date is already closed. Is there any provision for him to do the improvement once again? So that if he is interested, no.
MOOCs and EDX and Swayam doesn't come into picture. It is the individual school, university, board for them to decide. In fact, I would like that platforms like Swayam be made available so that anybody who wants to study can study. But when it comes to formal evaluation and certification, that will have to be in the control of appropriate teachers, schools, boards and appropriate authorities. Another great advantage of this is, even in a class of 40, 50, 60, we know there are some students who are quick, fast, very easily they understand the subject. They may get bored at your pace of things. But give him the videos, he will, while listening to Amir Khan's movie, he will go through it, absorb it, he will come next Monday morning, give your examination and do very well in it. What is wrong in it? There will be some other students, for him your routine teaching, routine speed of, normal speed of teaching is too fast. He is unable to absorb it. But videos he can, at his home, whenever he is comfortable, he can go through 10 times, 15 times. Till he absorbs.
When the term school was coined, so please correct me if I'm wrong, I heard that it was like something at your own pace and at your own leisure.
That was the Gurukul type of.
Yes, yes. Yeah. So with MOOC, it's up to me.
Yes, it's up
my
to you.
My pace and my view of seeing the things. I think it's more of an informal way of having the knowledge, MOOCs.
See, look. When earlier you had to learn by visiting a guru and listening to his work, then people started writing things down, but at a small level. When books came, Gutenberg's press and all that, some people thought now schools will be useless, all knowledge will be in books. That didn't happen. Books only facilitated. So when a teacher talks, even if a guru must have an excellent patience, because with each student he can spend enough time at his pace. A normal teacher who teaches a class of 60, he cannot teach 60 different ways simultaneously to the 60 different students. Whereas a book, unlike a class or even a video, a book has a great advantage is that it is time independent. You can read it while sleeping, while traveling in a bus, okay, at your pace. At any point you can stop, go back, you can just, oh, aisa kya, think for 10 minutes, ah, now let me proceed. So this is another facility. Instead of a simply printed book, this is another medium where not only print, but audio, video, some action, some experiment which you can do. You can read a chemistry book, but you cannot even simulate a chemistry experiment. But you can set up a simulated chemistry lab where he can do titration. You can put hydrochloric acid and go on dripping NaOH in it and see how the color of that phenolphthalein or something changes. That's the tracer indicator. That you can do. It doesn't replace the chemistry lab, but at least halfway you can do.
So maybe in the future, in order to, check the progress of the student in the descriptive format, we can have a software that a student has to install in its system, so it will track the key, that konsi key press key, maybe
what
it could be somewhere.
What we can do in the future is all open, okay, and I hope the Swayam platform version 2, 3, 4 goes on improving.
Ultimately, these MOOCs are not in an attempt to replace our
format. No, it's not replacement, it's an additional facility available. Yes.
To have a hunger for more knowledge and in a different way, so this is an opportunity for them. So I think this thing we have to understand.